Hello, hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome, welcome to the NA Ladder Heroes February monthly finals. That's the EU Ladder Heroes transition. What's up? Okay, this is just going to be one of those days today. How you doing today, Wardy? I've had an interesting day. So, to start off with, first of all, apparently my overlay says that Masa is 5-2 versus the ladder right now. Let's fix that. But it's been a very, 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 very interesting day because today I woke up at 3 in the morning and my internet was completely dead. And EU Ladder Heroes Monthly Final was supposed to start in 5 hours. So then I coordinated and tried to see if all the players were willing to postpone the monthly finals for like 2 hours so that I could get my internet fixed in time and broadcast, but they weren't able to because some of them were busy, so I had to have all of them play out the matches, and we're going to actually be casting the EU Ladder Heroes monthly finals, for those who are wondering, after this from replays, and I'm going to be probably casting that with Tempo because I can only take so much of Wardy, alright? His trolling in the chat just eventually takes a toll on my mind. No, but it's going to be great to have Wardy here. But yes, that was a whole thing, and I'll go into that later for those who end up tuning in for that and stick around after the NA Ladder Heroes Multifinals. But we do have the NA Ladder Heroes Multifinals coming on up. It's going to be pretty awesome, and for those who are tuning in maybe for the first time, if you're coming through the TL calendar event, if you're coming in off of Total Biscuit's recommendation, you saw the advertisement that was played earlier on the Shoutcraft stream, well, I got a little video for you that will tell you a little bit about what this tournament is. Welcome to your introduction to Ladder Heroes. Ladder Heroes is a Blizzard-sponsored competition that is constantly ongoing on the North American and European ladders. Here's how it works. Players register for Ladder Heroes with unshared accounts that use their real names. No barcodes allowed. We track the top players on the North American and European ladders over on the website www.ladderhero.es, which updates every minute with the most recent standings. Every Saturday, the top 6 Grandmaster players in each region earn themselves a bit of cash totaling up to $150. The top 20 earn themselves points that go toward qualifying for the monthly finals. At the end of the month, a $400 monthly finals is held for the top 12 point holders to crown the king of the ladder for that month. And that's Ladder Heroes in a nutshell. Good luck out there. Okay, so hopefully you guys found that a little bit enlightening if you weren't familiar with Ladder Heroes. If you already knew what Ladder Heroes was, hopefully that just clarifies some of the random details about it. But we are going to be hopping into our first game relatively shortly. It's going to be Raze versus Jim Rising as I finally get that overlay corrected. Should be a cool TVZ. Of course, we do have a lot of really cool players that managed to qualify for this month of the Ladder Heroes. We had Jens and Jig, and for those who do not know who Jens is, formerly known as Jarpy, did officially name change and everything. Jon Snow versus Tesla. We have Raze versus Jim Rising. Game Time versus Sanagi. And then, of course, the seeded players that just laddered a little bit extra more than everybody else. We have True, Optimus, Peely Peely, and Cham. And, Wardy, I know that you were saying Optimus is probably one of the really good players that are signed to, or managed to qualify for this month.
Yeah, I think Optimus is going to take it. I'm just going to say he's going to win the full thing. Really? I've got nothing else to say, yeah.
Even over
Yeah, he's not going to drop a map.
Okay, that's a bit of a stretch, but
I don't know, man. What am I meant to say? I might just be muted again, so what I say might not even matter.
Look, man, look. Okay, give me some slack. I've gotten 3 hours of sleep, okay?
Yeah.
You know the kind of stuff I had to pull up with today?
I make these excuses up as well all the time.
Optimus got a virus after doing well in the EU Ladder Heroes Monthly Finals. I won't give too many spoilers about like too much of the details, but he knocked somebody out, then got a virus on his computer and had to drop out. And we had to replace him with the other person he just beat. And he had already started his next series and was up 1-0 in that match. Like, I've been dealing
with
that.
His opponent literally had to install the virus to beat him.
Namshar was on his way over to like a place where he could play StarCraft, and his train got canceled. Like, it just straight, not like he missed his train, his train got canceled, and he had to forfeit out because he was going to get back home like too late to actually play. It was just, there's just been so many things that have been going on today that have been an absolute mess. So you know what, Wordy, I get a little slack today. I get a little bit of slack.
Okay, I'll let you off. I think Optimus is has a good opportunity to go far. I mean, obviously meeting True potentially in the semis could suck, but I don't think True is like unbeatable right now. That sort of stage where he wins a lot and he loses a lot. You know, it's he's one of those. I don't know how to say it, but it's true, right? Like True struggles with consistency. I feel a lot of the time, and at the moment, I feel he's in a bit of a slump, perhaps. I think the bottom side of the bracket's interesting too, though. Pili Pili, Cham coming in the round of eight already. I think they're going to have pretty good chances too. Pili's been playing really well lately, actually, like really well. So that could be quite interesting also.
Yeah, definitely. I think that Pili Pili is, he's one of those guys that is really hit or miss. Sometimes he shows up and he is just unbelievably strong. And sometimes he shows up and you're like, I haven't seen Pili Pili play like that since I thought he was still like low GM.
Maybe it's the Psystorm curse. They just can't play reliably. That's what you're saying.
You know what? I would believe that, but I will also say that Jon Snow is probably one of the most consistent players in terms of performance. He doesn't really have a lot of highs, but he also doesn't really have a lot of lows. Like, there's very few times I'm like, oh, Jon Snow got beaten by a player that I consider he's much, much better than. Usually he's pretty par for the course. But also, like, because of that, he didn't really have a huge number of breakout performances. Until I would say, like, Cheezadelphia, the last one, which is a North American LAN, for those not familiar with it. And he ended up beating, like, Masa, ended up beating, like, a ton of really good players, even beat Suppy in the finals, who still plays pretty well. But he has just been doing super-duper amazingly good. But LaserSEQ, by the way, thank you so much for the 11-month resub, saying supply drop flies away. But I think that we're just waiting on the lobby to be made for this first series. I know that Raze is online, Jim Rising is online, so I guess they're just finishing up their map vetoes and stuff.
Yeah, it takes a little while. I think Raze came on like a few minutes late, so.
Yeah, for those who don't
away from those vetoes.
Yeah, for those who don't know, Raze is also Tesla's brother, and I'm pretty sure the reason Raze was up and ready on time and everything, he was like ready to go before we started. But I think he had to go AFK for a little bit because his brother was not quite online, and I had to tell Raze, like, hey, dude, where's your brother, man? Like, he's also supposed to be playing. He's like, I don't know. I woke him up 20 minutes ago, and he's, like, not here. Just, I don't know what the hell he's doing. He's like, all right, be right back. Went and woke him up.
It's like late morning.
Right?
No, it's not even morning. It's, like, afternoon everywhere in the US.
They're on the East Coast, too. It's, like, 3 p.m. for them.
That's crazy. Especially, because your time zone's all messed up at the minute. Because you decided to turn your clock forwards early for no reason.
I know, and then poor Optimus is over here, and it's like almost it's getting close to the point where it's actually, I think it's going to be past midnight pretty soon, right? No. It's like 9 o'clock or something on the East
Coast. It's 8 p.m. It's 8 p.m. for the Optimus.
Okay, that's not too bad.
You would have been right at 9 o'clock if the clocks went wrong, basically.
God damn it. God damn you, daylight savings time.
Your clocks are wrong at the minute. Yeah. It just doesn't make sense. There's only like 4 hours between me and like East Coast America. It makes no sense.
That's pretty crazy. But as we said, Raze versus Jim Rising is going to be the first match that we'll be broadcasting. And taking a look at their match history, just to give you an idea of kind of what we're going to be seeing. They've only really played one match ever, and it was like early 2016. So I don't know how much we can really glean from it, but even though it's only one match, it was a while ago, it was only a best of three. The fact that Jim Rising took that series is not really too much of a surprise to me. I think that Jim Rising is just the more accomplished player here. Raze is probably one of the better players, or the better Terran players in all of North America, but it's also kind of in the context of there aren't really that many great Terran players in North America. He's probably still at least even with Semper and probably still a little bit behind Masa. And Jim Rising has just been a player that I think has been in the scene for a really long time. He's actually gotten decent results, even though I think that he is kind of half retired as a player at this point. He's just commentating in Spanish.
Jim Rising's a man of many talents, man. He can play, he can talk.
That's true. He can cheese.
Like, I'm just playing, Rafi.
Okay. Whatever,
Con,
man.
Think of a new one. Con.
All right.
Con, it's your turn.
It's my turn?
You can speak Spanish. There you go.
Yo hablo español. Yo soy una vaca loco porque yo como yo. Estoy estando aquí. Anyone that knows Spanish now has lost all degrees of respect for me.
No me gusta nada, Fear Dragon.
Oh.
Oh.
I didn't know you speak the Espanol.
Un poco.
Un poco.
Or I should say un poquito. Have I never told you about the story of my Spanish speaking exam at uni?
No. Did you take Spanish in university?
For like an extra module thing. It was like beginner's Spanish. So it's pretty much primarily coursework, right? So basically you can get by just like using Google Translate. It's like your coursework is like, it's like a mixture of coursework where you show you're learning yourself in your own time. And then you do some exams, which you can sort of just cram for a bit. So I get to my speaking exam and I'm like, I can't speak a word of Spanish. I'm like, yo, me amo Wardy, what's up? only we start off and they don't even ask me what my name is. So that wasn't exactly a hot start. And they were like, it was pretty basic questions. They were like, so what does your dad work as? And I'm like, oh, I understood what that question means, but I have no idea how to respond to it. So I'm like, I really couldn't figure anything. And it came to me, I was like, a student, not a sentence, just a student. And they were like, okay, well, that's just cheating. So then they were like, well, he thinks he's being clever, we'll be clever. And they were like, what does your mum work as? And I was like, oh man. They got me good. And then I was like, then it came to me and I was like, a fireman, not even firewoman, a fireman. And they laughed. And because they laughed, I got extra points because it was distracting to my exam.
Wow. Jeez. That is.
That's how you pass Spanish, beginners, by knowing nothing. It's kind of sad, really. Spent an entire year learning Spanish. I can't speak a word.
Yeah, I feel like you forget Spanish very, very quickly. My only story from my Spanish class from back in the day was that I borrowed a pencil freshman year of high school, and I borrowed two pencils from one of my friends, okay? And I told my friend, like, I could not, for some reason, ever remember to actually go get a pencil, like, go get another pencil and return it or something to my friend. So I told him, like, okay, whatever, dude, I'll pay you, like, 1 cent interest every day that I do not give you, like, back your pencils. So it's been almost 13 years, and I did the calculation. I got dinner with my friend last night, and I owe him $95.
God, that's an expensive pencil.
It's two really expensive pencils.
That's like your library bills that add up. Yeah. Library fine. So it's like, it's only 5 pence, and you go to the library like, okay, to get another book, you need to pay us like £50. Like, what?
It's insane.
No. And they're like, you haven't been here for like 2 years. I'm like, oh, it's been that long since I studied. God damn it.
Yeah. By the way, guys, we were not just talking about Spanish and pencils because we wanted to, and we were delaying the tournament. We were waiting for the players to finally be ready. It looked like Jim Rising was in the bathroom. So we're going to hop over to that map intro, and we'll see you guys in a bit. Hello, hello, ladies and gentlemen. Here we are in our first game of the NA Light of Heroes February Monthly Finals. Spawning up here in the top left-hand corner of the map, we have the yellow Zerg player. Give it up for Jim Rising. Currently teamless, but he's representing Mexico and, of course, casters and commentators everywhere.
He's repping us. Bottom right-hand side, representing Sloth Esports Club, we do have our purple Terran player, It is rays. Talk to me, Ravi. Tell me about rays a bit more. I want to hear more about him.
Raze is a really fun player to watch because he is a lot like I think a lot of other really fun players to watch. Scarlet always came to mind for me as a player that kind of had this sort of playstyle where there's two different extremes of the spectrum. He can be that really solid macro player who really likes to take it to the late game and really just play a good old macro standard game. And then he has what he calls the meme builds, which are just the cheesiest, like, most ridiculous kind of plays. Like, the things that you look at now, and you're like, this reminds me of Terran back in Wings of Liberty when they just had 20 different variations of one base all-ins. And Raze just has those kind of two different modes, and I'm always interested whenever I'm looking at a Raze game, which mode is he bringing out this time?
Alright. That's, it's always fun, I think, when people can, like, do two very different things, right? Because then you just don't know what to expect, and the games can be fun, it's not always the same. It's nice. TVZ here for our first matchup of the day. TVZ's meta has changed so much since we last cast together, man. It's, crazy. Last time we cast 2016. TVZ, it was like... Yo, was
last year,
last
man!
Did we not cast this year yet?
I don't think so.
Surely we did.
I think that's the last time we cast was when you stayed at my place.
Was it really?
I think so.
Did I not do Ladder Heroes in like December or something?
That was last year.
Well, yeah, I know, but that was after I stayed at your place.
Maybe. I think that you did Ladder Heroes when you were at my place.
No, I know I did that. Yeah, I know that. Okay.
By
okay,
the way, this is right. Kind of interesting to me. I don't know if what you think about this, but like, I feel like this is normally the time that I normally end up seeing Jim Rising or like Zerg players in general start making some more Zerglings, but Jim Rising is just sticking around on four Zerglings. The Hellions are now making their way across the map with like four Hellions and even another fifth one coming. Jim Rising just doesn't have anything besides Queens.
Queens are pretty good, man.
I mean,
you might not know this as a Protoss player, but Queens just kill everything. I think as long as he's like walled up at the front like he is now, and as long as the Queens sort of stick here, it's not really worth the Hellions driving by, because they need to kill more than 10 workers to be worthwhile, more or less. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're going to try for it, but I mean, even these four Zergans, they catch one right away. And now there's three Hellions in the main, which will get some damage done, but probably not enough, and Zergans will just clean this up. That was a nice little defense there by Jim Rising, actually. I mean, four Hellions or three drones is not worthwhile, although he is still building more Hellions, which can act in two ways. A, it means losing the first ones doesn't matter so much, but B, it means he's going to have less Hellbats for this armory coming up, so... It's a bit of a weird mixture that's coming through right now for Raze. As we see some Ling's going to try and counterattack, but that should be enough Hellions to turn this away, maybe? No, he actually pulls up to the high ground.
Yeah, I think he needs to pull up the high ground just to keep as many of those SCVs alive as possible, and he can immediately return them. Loses a bit of mining time, but better to lose mining time than lose workers, I guess.
Yeah, of course. I mean, I feel he wasn't far away from getting enough to defend, right? So it wasn't that big of a deal losing the mining time. It's just a couple of seconds. And he'll get back to mine right now. This Viking doing a good job picking off overlords in the middle of the map, by the way. We can get second kill of the game already, which is, again, nice. You know, force some more overlords to come out. Cleaning up some vision is always great as well. What did the Zerglings see, by the way? Did they see the Cloak Banshee? They saw a tech lab on the starboard, so they have a pretty decent idea.
Yeah, and he's already thrown up the spore crawlers and everything, which he may have done just as a safety precaution anyway. Seems pretty common to do, but... Here we go. Here come the Hellbats, and Jim Rising's got three queens over here with a couple of Zerglings.
Yeah, okay. Queens are pretty good, but against the Hellbats and the Banshee and a landed Viking now, he does need a little bit more, and the Bane's on the way, but not very quickly. And actually, I thought he was going to get rid of that first Bane and morphing, but he doesn't quite make it. There's a Banshee and Hellbats still working their way through. A couple more Banes about to finish, but still, I mean, the splits are good, right? So Raze is doing quite a lot of damage with this already. Jim Rising is sort of waiting for a Spire, but that's going to be a long time until it finishes with these Queens. He's picking up more damage.
Yeah, but Jim Rising did a really nice job focus firing down the Banshee and all the units that were going to be really difficult to contend with. He was able to take out. Now he still has to deal with these Hellbats, and he only has Zerglings coming out, so that will still be a little bit of a difficult situation, but he's doing an okay job. He's starting to whittle away at these Hellbats. I think he may eventually be able to clean up with the Queens. He hasn't really taken a lot of drone damage.
I mean, the meters are about to pop out, so they will eventually go down, but I mean, he's still lost so many units just trying to deal with what's a relatively low commitment out of Raze. He's back at home, throwing down more factories, a four on the way up as well. He's already got a third CC building. Like, Raze in a great position. His drones are very nearly going down there. He has to keep those running. Because finally, the Queens do clean this out.
Yeah. Third command center, like you said, is going to be on the way. And of course, Gem Rising really wasn't mining from that third during that entire time. So there was a lot of lost mining time. You can actually see things, income advantage just spiking up in terms of Raze's favor. It's going to go down a little bit because now Gem Rising is getting back to mining. But well, we'll see if Gem Rising can turn things around a little bit with those mutas.
Yeah, I mean, the Mutas are nice, but there's already, what, like a four up, a couple of Vikings in the sky as well. It's going to be really difficult to get too much done. And how many does he have? He's going to have five in total, like, to start with. And it's not that many, and, I mean, Ray is going into mech, by the way, which you mentioned with the extra factories, but it is such a great map to play mech on. It's so difficult to attack into the three, four bases of the Terran player here, so this is looking pretty awesome for Ray's, I feel like. Ahead in workers, he's got Vikings and a four against the Mutas, which aren't really probably going to do too much. I mean, even if they do, I feel as though they're not quite going to get the damage they need to, like, justify the investment. I guess we'll see as they come across the map, but it's going to be really difficult. And he's heading towards the natural where there's two fours and the Vikings as well. Like, the Vikings are in perfect position.
There's also a Banshee inside of Gem Rising's main base now. The queens are trying, one queen is trying to chase it down, but he's going to end up losing quite a few more drones. Where are the spore crawlers he made earlier? I don't see them anywhere in sight.
I think he only made one and he just kept it alive in the natural. Maybe he cancelled the main base one and felt he didn't need it or so. Especially if like the lair finishing so quickly, you have the overseers coming out. So, I mean, I guess that's kind of what happened. And it costs him a few extra drones now in the main base. So again, Ray is doing good damage. And when you pull ahead as a mech player, it's so difficult to lose that advantage because you're just going to have such a powerful army. And the Zerg is generally one that's meant to kind of outmax you and just have more eco. But that's not what, you know, that's not where this game is going right now. It's the Terran play with all of the advantages. So it's going to be a tough one for Gem Rising, and he really has to find something with these mutas. Even if it's just a few workers here and there, just to start doing damage, would, you know, at least start pulling him back into this a little bit.
Yeah, I definitely agree. But it's going to be so, so difficult with just such a low muta count. He's starting to add on more mutalists, going up to, I think, around 12 or so. So maybe he can make something happen with those. But he is also throwing up Infestation Pit. He got up a Roachborn. He's just getting up all the other forms of tech and kind of taking advantage of the short period of time where Terran players going mech don't really have a way of putting on pressure besides just Hellion runbys.
Man, I don't really like the fact that he's making more mutalists because it feels as though he's just putting more gas into a tech, which is not really going to gain him that much more. I mean, surely he's already seen the fact that there's a couple of fours up, the turrets, etc. The problem is he's not going to go past like 12 or so mutalists. And so if he doesn't go past that number, he's never going to get rid of the turrets very effectively. So going up to like a few extra isn't really going to give him that many more possibilities. I mean, maybe he can jump in now and try and grab himself an SEV Claw 2. Actually, Raze, he's a little bit slow to repair that turret in the natural, so he will have that fall early, and suddenly Gem Rising does get a bit more of an opportunity. But again, I mean, four workers a turret, it's still not quite enough. He needs to keep finding more, and that will be difficult as Bane's going to burst through the right-hand side at the same time.
Oh, no, they go after the supply depot as they finish him off. I think that was a misclick instead of going after the worker line, but I guess it's at least going to force Raze to try and reproduce some of those supply depots. Missile turret inside the natural expansion also going to go down, so Gem Rising not getting a ton. I mean, he does get 11 worker kills, which is definitely not bad, but also opening up opportunities for attack later on, just buying himself time, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean, getting rid of the depots now does open it up, but I mean, it's so quick and easy for Raze to rebuild them. And if you just had Banelands hitting your wall, surely you're going to think, like, okay, well, I better not leave that open in case it has the same again. So Raze has rebuilt that, as you see. Well, Gem Rising's about to have a hive finish in with the hive tech. And he has that possibility of going in towards Vipers, etc. But he still needs some more stuff on the ground. And as it stands, he's got like 14 roaches. He's not really going to contest as Raze up on four bases. Again, looking super safe, super solid so far in game number one of our NA ladder heroes.
17 Hydras on the way. Could make something happen. And I've got to commend Gem Rising for how much damage these mutas have started to do to the economy in terms of, like, workers killed. He's been able to kill off, what is that, 17 workers? I mean, definitely not too bad, because Yuzzle hasn't lost too many of the mutas, but at the same time, raises at 73 workers. Wardy, this is at that point where, yeah, I know that they're both sitting on four bases, but this may be too many workers for Raze.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, maybe he's just overbuilding because he knows he might lose a few more to the mutas. I mean, the mutas are doing a really decent job picking off workers, but again, if you're picking off workers and the Terran player is at 70 plus anyways, is it going to make a difference? You know, is that the advantage? Yeah. Well, no, you're still stuck with 10, 12 mutas, which are just going to be kind of dead supply when it comes to a fight, because they're just going to go down so quickly unless you can get rid of, somehow, all the Vikings, Liberators, and Fours with the Roaches and Hydras, which is very unlikely to happen. you know, maybe you can get rid of a couple of them to get rid of all of them and then have the mutas come in as a follow-up. It's very difficult. So you see Ray is actually starting on Siege, maybe pushing a bit further forwards now. Does he want to move across the map? I don't think he wants to wait too much longer. I mean, he has +2 weapons and he's about to max out. So the longer he waits, the more he's just allowing Jim Ryzen to build up a bank to rebuild after a fight. So I think Ray should start trying to get going as soon as possible, really. And he is starting to move.
Yep, takes down the destructible rocks. Gonna encounter a bit of Jim Rising's army, which is not all clumped up together just yet. And Jim Rising's still waiting on some of those upgrades. I think if he pulls back, just buys himself an extra 10 or 15 seconds, he will be able to finish this up. But he's getting engaged before he finishes up his own 2-2 upgrades and loses a ton of units. I guess trying to count on the fact that those Siege Tanks were unsieged, but he definitely eats some pretty big shots in the context of that. Also going for some harassment inside the main base of the Mutas.
Well, the Mutas are starting to take some damage to the Liberators, and the Liberators are just going to pick up every single Mutalist Ravi. Wow, I mean, that's just huge.
But all every the Siege Tanks in the center all get blinding clouded. The Thor is also not able to get involved in the fight. The Hydras and the Roaches catch us on the backside and clean up all of the tanks, and every single one of these Thors is going to go down.
Wow, what a weird turn of events. Like, Ray's like, going to kill all the Mutas in the main, then he loses his entire army out on the map at the same time. Viper's really been MVP there. I mean, as always, basically, in this composition, the blinding clouds will determine engagements and how they end up. So I want to just go the way of Jim Ryzen in the middle. And now he has, like, you know, an extra 60 supply over his opponent. And, well, I mean, it's a better position than I've always been in for the rest of the game. And also, if an Ultra Cavern finishes, he's going to start making a few of those Ultras, too. So that has a lot of Hydras to utilize as well. And he's going to start pushing across the map with them, but does have to be careful because he's missing those Vipers. And he did lose them during the fight, so he's having to rebuild them. Doesn't have those to help out just yet. However, he's gonna find the Liberators here. Oh, that's really nice.
God, catching Siege is such a big deal. When you're on this mech army, you cannot afford to be caught in those kind of situations. Fifth expansion may even end up falling. Hydra DPS is just a little bit too strong.
Yeah, those Hydras are way too good. Now they're gonna move up this ramp. We're gonna see a few more Siege Tanks just Siege Dragon towards this ramp. And well, the Hydras maybe just keep moving forwards, but the Vipers are here, but they don't have energy to do anything. I mean, they can abduct. No, they can't even abduct. They don't have any energy. So everything is going to end up full of a Jim Ryzen, but he does have a bank to rebuild at least, right? So
yeah,
that's a positive. I mean,
he also killed off the fifth of Raze, it's going to be a lot harder for Raze to compete. He's already starting to mine out a lot from his natural expansion. Third expansion starting to run a little bit dry. So Raze does not have as stellar of an economy by any means.
Actually, Jim Ryzen's economy is pretty sick. 80 drones, he's got 6 hatcheries up. He's got everything he needs to kind of stay solid in this game throughout. Raze will actually lift his main and relocate it towards the forward base, which he just lost. So, I mean, it's not the end of the world for Raze. I mean, I think killing all those Hydras definitely helps him out a lot. But I guess my new question is he going to have enough to defend against the incoming army, which is, again, now going to have full energy Vipers. He's going to have Ultras to just be a bit tankier as they run on forwards. And they can be pretty difficult to get rid of as well. So it's going to be very difficult for Raze to fight against this. We'll have to see how this is going to go. There's a few Hellions coming up to the top side. I'm just going to get Spine crawled away at and pushed away over to the right as well.
Yeah, I would be lying, Wordy, if I said that I thought Mech would continue to do better and better on this map. Because if you look at how he's going to have to expand as this game goes on, if it continues going to the later stages of the game, this map really starts to spread you out in terms of your bases. It's going to be really difficult for an immobile mech army, which cannot get caught on Siege, if there's anything we've learned from those last couple of engagements, to defend all your bases and always be in position.
Yeah, this map's very much so about getting 5 bases super easily as mech and winning on 5 bases, which is a lot of bases. Mm-hmm. But you're right, eventually, if you have to take more than that, it's going to be very difficult. And so Raze has been on a bit of a timer. Let's see if he can defend against this push right now. He's coming into the high ground, and he raises on the low ground, so he's not in the best position to start with. And those tanks are very clumped. The blinding clouds will start dropping, and the ultras will keep running forwards. Man, these tanks are in so much trouble.
Yeah.
So much trouble. Like, 2 ultras are just working their way through all of them, although they do come off their blind cloud, although more put down. 1 hero ultra makes his way through the low ground army. He wouldn't mind mixing as well, by the way. It's a pretty interesting little addition. They work pretty well against ultras, but it's sort of a weird thing to suddenly switch into and use up factory build time for at this point, I feel.
Yeah, I can definitely see what you mean. And of course, it is a lot of supply that ends up going to those widow mines. That, I mean, you see that they get involved in the fight the very end after everything else was gone down. But I do feel like Raze, he just wasn't quite entirely sieged up for that engagement. And you can see how much he suffers for it now, sitting down almost 100 supply. And yeah, he is going to push things back, but at what cost, Morty? He lost his 2 only mining bases.
I think that's the thing. Jim Rison's economy we talked about being great, and he keeps on expanding, by the way. Now up to 7th base bottom left and 8th base coming up top right. So he keeps expanding. He can afford to take trades such as this, but Rays really can't. And I mean, that's all shown in the supplies and in pretty much everything at this point, production tabs and everywhere, minimap. Jim Rison just has so much. He's just going to keep on pushing forwards. And even if he doesn't take great trades at this point, it's still probably going to be good enough to push through and bring him victory here. He has a great Aspire. Not actually up, sorry. I just thought he would have because he's building Corruptors.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what the Corruptors are for then because I don't think the Air Army's really been that big of a deal. Maybe he just wants to prepare against potential extra Liberators coming into play.
I think it's also going to protect the Vipers, right? Because those Vikings and the Liberators been going after the Vipers. And I mean, he's been relying on those Blinding Clouds.
Yeah, Vipers are definitely something you want to try and protect. That's actually a pretty good call. I'll go with that. It seems like, I don't know though, like, because sometimes it feels as though anyways, like, the Vipers should just suicide it and you just rebuild them. Like, I know they're expensive, but you get so much value out of those spells they're casting.
That's the old school mentality that players would always have about, like, High Templars or even Ghosts, I remember. It's like, okay, well, you throw down the EMP and then they're just dead to you, or, like, Infestors. Yeah. Throw down the Fungal and they're dead to you now, right?
I guess it's also the fact that we can see everything, and obviously Jim Rising can't write us. Whoa, Widow Mines. I'm going to start killing a lot of Corruptors going to start dying. I was just going to say that Jim Rising doesn't necessarily see what Raze is rebuilding, right? So if there is suddenly a whole bunch more Liberators, the Corruptors would be super useful. So I think it might just be one of those situations where, you know, we're super awesome and get to see everything, but Jim Rising can't. And so he just has to make those Corruptors for safety's sake. He's rebuilding them, so I mean, he obviously feels as though they're important to the composition. Hey, I mean, they have roles to play, it's just against what Raze has right now, they're maybe not quite as important as they would be in other situations.
Cyclones in the mix as well. A couple of Blinding Clouds do go down on the Siege Shanks. Some of Ducks actually also pulling the Siege Shanks further forward, and yeah, Raze is going to end up losing this base. I think that he's already dropped down so far in supply. He's one-third the supply of his opponents. I mean, can he really end up holding on here for very much longer?
Probably not. I mean, this is one of those situations where he's kind of been dead since like a fight a few minutes ago, but obviously it takes a while to really kill off a mech player who time after time is able to rebuild into this, you know, a few tanks, and you gotta wait for the Vipers to come back up with energy once again to abduct the Planet Cloud. And as we do see, I mean, even these couple of ultras going down once again. And Jim Rising, he's got money in the bank, though. He's even starting a great Aspire now eventually, and more Corruptors on the way. I really hope he doesn't just wait for, like, you know, Broodlords to come up to end this, because it's really unnecessary, but he might just to play it out safely as well, you know?
Yeah, I think also if you take a look at Raze's vision, like, he kind of has some idea of how many bases Jim Rising has been taken, and just the fact that he knows, like, I am on a quarter of a mining base because I have 14 workers, and I am only really mining effectively from one base. He should have some a good idea, and I guess he's going to try and push out because he says, well, I took care of your army. I imagine if he isn't able to make something miraculous happen with this, and by miraculous, I mean Jim Rising accidentally regular move commands his army into Raze's sieged up siege tanks twice. And I don't even actually think that's possible with the Broodlords coming out.
I don't think it's really possible over Raze. I mean, he'll make a push because he has to try something, right? But
yeah,
as you mentioned, I mean, the Broodlords especially, just in case the game wasn't over enough, the Broodlords will just five times over make sure that Raze has absolutely no shot at this, because the last thing Raze has right now is the money to add extra starports and to start building up in towards Vikings and any sort of anti-air. And even if he does, there's so many Corruptors on the way out, how is he ever really going to contend with it? He just doesn't. And as his Broodlords sort of drop on down,
stop hitting yourself. GG gets called. Jim Rising. Game number one.
Man, we know we're just talking about I should open expert because I felt lost without it. I just pressed my hotkey to take this out of game. Oh.
Don't worry, you made up for the fact that XSplit was being super slow and wasn't actually seen transitioning for me.
So, fair enough.
Pass that power along.
Some sirens outside, how exciting.
Those are the victory sirens because Jim Rising took a pretty dominant victory in that game. He did a great job holding off the early aggression of Raze. It took a little bit of extra damage, I think, against like the big Hellbat attack and everything. Like the follow-up push did some good damage, but he was able to catch that army and when it was unsieged, and that just gave him so much of an advantage. He just had way too much room to kind of do everything he wanted to with his economy.
Yeah, I mean, it was the perfect situation for Jim Rising. So much of the game against mech can be just getting through the first wave and getting some momentum on your side. And with that momentum, The mech player starts to struggle. He gets pushed back a bit more each time and suddenly just can't keep up any longer. And Jim Ryzen found that initial bit of momentum, which is what he sort of really needed. I mean, you imagine he doesn't, Razor doesn't lose that entire army in the middle. All of a sudden, Jim Ryzen's the one who's remaxed and rebuilding and trying to defend against this ever-pushing mech army. And it's a completely different situation. So Jim Ryzen did a good job to kind of, I guess, take advantage of the fact that the Mirrors were distracting some of the air units, etc., and just being a distraction in general to kind of take Razor's attention away and to create that fight in the center.
All right, but we get ready to hop into game number 2 in this best of 3 from the round of 12, by the way. I don't know why I still have this saying that it's from the ladder. This is not from the ladder. This is from the round of 12. Ladder heroes, but here we are. Spawning down here in the bottom right-hand corner of the map, we have the yellow Zerg player sitting up 1-0. Give it up for the Mexican Zerg commentator. It's Jim Rising.
And the other left-hand side is going to be our Purple Terran player. May change things up a bit this time, bit of a different map, so we'll see what he has planned. It is Raze. You're on Belshire Vestige game number 2. I really feel you should make ladder heroes when a few finals take place on the ladder. You
How?
Just have to, everyone just has to queue and you just ask Blizzard to ban everyone else from the ladder for a little while.
Just ban everybody else from the ladder. Mm. Or how about this? That's how the tournament bracket is decided. It's just whoever you end up against.
On the ladder, yeah. And if you play someone who's not in the tournament, you just have to like instantly even queue again.
Yeah.
Seems like a good deal. One guy just never gets anyone for the tournament, ends up winning.
That would actually be a that would be a really interesting format where you legitimately have a tournament like that. Players just queue up, and you queue up until you find somebody that's in the tournament. You play against them. It's a best of one. Loser gets knocked out, and then you just keep playing until you play against somebody else that's still in the tournament.
That's so abusable.
Yeah, I mean, you could just be like, oh, I'm queued up, but I'm not finding anybody. And they're like, oh, cool, I'm in the semifinals without playing a match.
It's like you're just like sniping people on your like other accounts as well to make sure they don't go up against you. And you're like, okay, I see he's in game right now. I'm gonna tournament takes like 7 days.
Bracket fixing boys.
Oh dear.
Okay, well, we do have a 1-1-1 opening, or most likely it's gonna be a 1-1-1 opening. I one time cursed myself by saying, oh, there's the factory plopping down, there's not a second barracks, it's a 1-1-1. And then the player just dropped down to second and third barracks and just went
That's pretty weak, crazy
aggressive.
I mean, I guess, off of one guess here, it's probably looking like a pretty fast third CC coming down. So there's the possibility to still sit on just the, he's going to go second gas. They could have, if he goes one gas and third CC, he can drop down like 2 extra racks before a starport. So,
yeah.
But I think with the double gas, he will look towards a starport fairly soon with just some helium production to really start us off as this factory finishes. Let's see if we will patrol, get ready to pop down that starport. Exciting life in the Terran base right now.
Yep, and in the last game, we saw that Raze kind of pulled up some of his Hellions. He waited until he had 4, kind of that old school style of the big Hellion push in.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like Jim Rising kind of got away with a little bit of greed there, because he had 4 Zergans, and yeah, he had a couple of queens, but it wasn't the crazy high number of queens that you sometimes would see Zerg players go for. He didn't get up like 7 queens, he just had 4 queens, and it was defending 3 different bases, so I almost would like to maybe see Raze move out immediately with these first Hellions, but he's not going to do so.
Yeah, I was talking to Hero Marine a lot. I am kind of vits about this. We were watching some TVZ series, and we were discussing kind of like sacrificing the first Hellions for drones, and Hero Marine was just like, well, I don't understand why people ever do it, because you just don't get value out of it. Like, 4 Hellions is like 400 minerals, and yeah, like, if you kill like 8 drones, it seems great, but if you think about it, that's still only 400 minerals, and he can now just make 8 drones for free because he knows you've just killed all your Hellions, right?
Yeah.
So he's gotten, all of a sudden you've lost your map control with the Hellions and all the rest of it. So it's a pretty interesting one that people obviously have very different views about whether it's worth diving with the Hellions or not. And obviously last game, Raze felt as though he should. I mean, free work is definitely not enough, though. I think if you do go for this, you do want like at least 10 to start getting value and to make up for, again, the kind of what I just said, the lack of map control. Anyways, how about that coming in? Ravi, talk to us about it.
All right, well, Creaseford is pretty decent over here. It's going to make it a lot easier for the queens to all move into position. There are 4 queens and 12 zerglings, not that many units, and it's going to be a Liberator follow-up, not a Banshee follow-up this time. Hellbat's also getting healed up by a Medivac, so this is a much stronger push in than the last game on Abyssal Reef, and you can already see Raze is making some pretty good progress so far.
Yeah, Raze coming in very aggressively here and still chasing down to the bottom left side. He's going to pick off two of the queens. I wonder if he just goes for the kill on the hatchery or if he wants to pull back and still keep them trading. Looks like he just wants to kill the third, which of course would be a big victory for him. And as you see the couple of roaches start to come in, I mean, he can turn and fight this still though, and I mean, he still is turning and fight this. A Reaper grenade goes down too, because the Reaper's still around. Oh, I mean, Raze has lost, well, barely anything. One Hellbat and one Marine going down throughout this fight. Finally, some extra roaches will start to really change this up, but the damage is real.
All the queens have been taken out. Two more queens are about to pop, and they could help to try and focus fire down the medevac. That would actually do a huge amount of damage to this push-in from Raze. And Raze is starting to get cleaned up slowly but surely over here. Medevac does go down. Drones being pulled off the line. And it does seem like, at the end of the day, Jim Rising may be able to hold over here. There aren't too many reinforcements coming out for Raze, but Raze has a third CC on the way. The Liberator, I think, there was a Liberator that was made, and Siege up in the main.
Yeah, that's the problem if you're losing the Queens. You just lost another one in the natural. You lose that mobile defense against these air-based units, and so already Raze is getting some damage done. He only has the one out. He's building the second one. But again, tonight he's going to force even more lost mining time. He's going to pick off a few workers. And so far, I mean, he's killed, what, like... I think he's only killed the six workers with the Liberator, but he did kill so many queens. And throughout this, I would say that this has been fantastic for Raze. He will just transition out of this so comfortably. This time, it's going to be extra barracks, Stimpak on the way. And we're going to see a bit of a bio-based follow-up compared to the mech we saw on Abyssal Reef.
Yeah, and of course, even on top of just the worker damage that he did, which wasn't a huge, huge amount, but it was also a lot of lost mining time. And like you said, the queens losing on those larva injects. There are just other ways that he gets a little bit further ahead. Running the Hellions in is interesting. I guess he's looking for a scout, I would imagine. And he did see the spire if he was paying attention and clicked on it.
Yeah, he should know that's a spire, right? I mean, why would you stop building like a spine crawler now?
Spine crawler, like, man. He's like, here's Liberators.
I guess a spore crawler, but would you build a spore crawler to the side of your main if there's Liberator?
My names. I mean, look at the spore crawler positioning of Jim Rising in the main base right now. You put spore crawlers in wherever you want, man.
Sure, but that's to kind of stop a unit from coming in. But like the natural, it doesn't really make any sense.
I agree.
It does. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe Jim Rising's intelligent.
You just don't know the NA ladder, man. You just don't know the NA meta.
I don't know the NA spore crawler positioning meta at all, clearly. That's clearly the issue, right?
Oh, that's weird. Roaches waltz their way into the main base, or sorry, the natural expansion of Raze.
Yeah, that is weird.
I can't tell who actually gets the better end of this. SCVs are going to be pulled off the line over here, but I feel like Raze kind of got the better end of that if he wasn't continuing to lose mining time right now. There we go.
I don't think so, because the roaches are pretty expendable. He doesn't really want to play roaches going forwards, I don't think. He's got link speed, he's going into a bay nest, and he's building mutas as well. So actually trading out the marines could have extra benefits for him in the next few moments. So I feel as though there's a lot of opportunity right now for Jim Rising to follow up quite nicely with that. Especially, again, because I think maybe if he's going to play Roach Ravager, then yeah, maybe it's not worthwhile to kill a few marines, because marines pop up a lot faster than Ravagers and roaches. But in this regard, you know, those roaches aren't really going to add too much on if you're not going to upgrade them and all the rest of it, so... I know what you mean, though. It's a tough one to call. Anyways, mutas approach the main base, and there's no turrets. Oh, sorry, there's one or two turrets up, but then weird locations where they're not quite covering actual mineral lines or entrances, so it's going to be a little bit tough, but marines come through, and he'll push those mutas away to begin with.
Yeah, those are what we call the zoning missile turrets. They don't actually protect the mineral lines, but they kind of say, no, you don't want to go this way. Just like reroute, direct into a different direction. And it is going to actually work out pretty well. And he has one missile turret at the third, which I really do like, since that is one of the further off bases to defend. It's going to take a little longer for the Marines to get there. Missile turret, at least by some time. Bunker does too.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing right now. Jim Rising, he won't do too much more for these mutas for a little while because he won't add to their numbers. Once you get like more mutas up and there's more action on the map, mutas counterattacks can be super awesome, but it'll be difficult for him to start making those happen because he's going to have to use them to help defend. So it's going to be a weird few moments. The fact that Raze actually has a couple of tanks won't really help him too much against this Ling Bay muta army. So that'll be interesting to see how it plays out. But I think one of the most important things really is just the upgrades that are already in play for our Terran player. 1-1 with +2 attack starting. I mean, Jim Rising only has +1 Carapace on the way, +1 melee. Are you still waiting for the second Evo Chamber to finish? So, not a great setup as the mutas do find a way in towards the main base once again. And they're doing a pretty okay job so far, just working their way through some Marines and a medevac. And just some bits and pieces in general. In fact, just completely shutting down the production.
he's going to be able to take out some of these reactors potentially. I mean, if he's able to continue to do the damage over here, he may have to pull back soon because Raze is getting awfully close to his base, but really good damage. Yeah,
it's a tough one. I wonder if he, Jim Ryzen just feels though he has enough to hold this off anyways. I mean, he's going to push forward. He's going to find another Siege Tank kill. That's the second one that's gone down over here now. And Marines are slowly working their way through the Mutas. And I guess the Muta count's getting a lot lower now. He could have gone in towards the Natural Mineral Line, which is also unprotected by a turret. But man, he's bought so much time for himself. And Jim Ryzen, he'll just rebuild those Mutas as well. 10 more on the way up.
Yeah, I mean, what was that? He traded out 7 Mutalists for probably 2 to 3 minutes of in-game time where he was going uninterrupted, as well as all of the other various units he killed off. Siege tanks, Marines that were popping out, even stimming up the entire army all the way back home. Jim Rising bought himself so much breathing space, and that fourth goes uninterrupted, sitting at 78 workers.
Yeah, he's up to the 4 bases nice for now, and he has started the melee upgrade too. Still, though, I mean, he's going to be behind heavily in upgrades, which is still a big advantage to Raze if he finds a larger fight. The one thing I still can't quite get over is the fact he's still making siege tanks rather than switching into Widow Mines, because when these Mutas are up, the siege tanks are a little bit more vulnerable because they're not as mobile. They don't help out against the Mutalists either. So it's kind of interesting that he's still kind of quite committed towards playing the siege tank based playstyle. As he pushes down the right, Mutas dive to the main base once more, and he's going to take out the turret. The Muta count very scary now, and SVs will begin to drop.
God, some Widow Mines could make or break a difference over here, but it's just not going to be the case. And going after the engineering base, going to shut down that upgrade advantage that Raze has been garnering in his favor for quite a bit of time, especially with plus one melee going on on the way. Well, that's still a little bit of a ways away. Raze has got to make something happen over here with this push.
Yeah, but how did he do it? 2 spine crawlers at the front, Ling Bane sat behind, ready to go. I mean, I guess the question is, when do you pull the Mutalists back, or do you just keep them over here? I mean, if 4 come into play now as well, he really wants to get his army. I feel as though he should go back through the natural and then kind of kill some SCVs and then maybe come and look around towards the bottom right side towards this army. Instead, he goes over to the left with the Mutas, which means that just in general, he's out of position to do anything. As Fear Banes do roll forwards, couple connections. Jim Ryzen doesn't have a lot back at home. He does have a few more Banes off to the left side, but it's getting a little bit scary for him. He has to start coming through with these Mutas, I think.
Yeah, he has 35 Banelings, though. Okay, there he is. He's going around from the other side. He's going to be able to move in over here and absolutely crush this army of Raze. Not a chance. Jim Ryzen, still surprisingly close in supply, but he just has such a massive army right now.
I think the Mutalists at this point started to make it very difficult for Raze, because now after fights, Jim Ryzen adds even more Mutas on, and they're already in a scary number, and if that keeps increasing, how does he ever really start to stop them? Turrets aren't going to do the job, the Marines are even being picked off here by a lot of Mutas, Medivacs keep dropping too, and Jim Ryzen is looking as though he might just move on through into the round of 8 of the NA ladder heroes, because he is really just putting on the hurt to Raze at the moment.
Yeah, Raze comes in with a huge flurry of Marines. I wonder if those were actually blocked in the main base, like the supply depots were raised or something like that. No pun intended. But Jim Rising now has that base on the left-hand side of the map, as well as his fourth expansion, so he is just completely outproducing Raze at this point.
Yeah, and now let me just come into the main base as well, which is more SCV kills, a reactor kill or two. Again, he's probably going to pick up some units as they pop out, and I mean, it's just a general nuisance. He's even going to go after the Orbital Command, and Raze is moving across the map. He's not going to turn around against this, so Raze is just going to say, right then, let's go, let's make this happen. But with what? I mean, his army's okay, but Jim Ryzen has Banes, he's got Lings producing, and again, he can always think about pulling those Mutas back home as well if he would like to. Bunker goes down to the Mutas now, and as Raze gets ready to push on up this ramp, the first few Banes will start to lead the charge. Here we go! Wow, there's this many Banelings. What are you meant to do? Even throwing someone to the floor is not... Okay, that was pretty terrible.
it's not that bad.
Yeah, I mean, if he didn't hit the floor with so many of those Banes, he would have cleaned out the rest of the Marines, because he had a lot of Banelings.
Yeah.
Hitting the floor, a bit of a mistake there. But I mean, the Mutas come over here, and now these Marines are super low health as well. I still think it's a little bit too much, really, for Jim Ryzen, especially if he just goes in with a little bit of Ling Bane with the Mutas at the same time.
Yeah, as soon as those Zerglings and the Banelings are able to back up the Mutas, there's no escape for this army of Raze. Now sitting down 60 supply to 133, GG gets called. Jim Rising takes the 2-0 and advances on to the round of 8.
GG, Jim Rising looked pretty good in these TVZs. Like, especially because I feel both games, the early aggression was... I think the early aggression was kind of like really favorable for Raze. So for Jim Rezner to kind of bounce back from that a couple of times.
In both games, right?
Yeah, in both games, I feel it went pretty well for Rays, like, early. So Jim Rezner bouncing back both times and making it happen. GG's.
Yeah, really, really well done. I think that's the funny thing that I really have been enjoying about Jim Rezner is back in the day, like 2012, 2013, 2014, even a little bit of 2015, I would say, Jim Rezner was the player. He was that guy that I would actually look at. And I would always think, okay, well, Mexican Zerg players, Jim Rezner and Cham, these are the cheesiest guys ever. Like, these are the guys who every single game relentlessly, like, you thought no regret, all-ins a lot. Jim Rezner and Cham used to all-in all the time. They used to just be constant baneling floods in every matchup. But they really have both become much, much better macro players. And Jim Rezner kind of showing his strength there and being able to come back in a game in the macro stages. But that is going to be it, and that does mean that Jim Rezner moves on to face off versus Peely Peely in the round of 8, and that is the last match to get started over there. I think we had Jig get a default victory over Jens, also known as, formerly known as Jarpy, so it looks like Jarpy didn't show up. Tesla ended up falling 2-0 versus Jon Snow, is now facing off versus Optimus. We have Game Time, who beat Sanagi 2-0, the only Korean in the... Oh, sorry, besides True, the only Korean in the tournament. You know, True is a kind of also important Korean.
True is an okayish Korean, I suppose. We can count him. We can count him.
But should be a pretty interesting lineup then, as we now have a Game Time versus Cham, Optimus versus Jon Snow, Jig versus True, and Jim Rezner versus Peely Peely. So we'll be back in just a little bit with more Ladder Heroes action. Please don't go anywhere.